On the other side of the enjoyment coin, we have Kingsglaive, where Advent Children was stupid but enjoyable, this movie is just stupid. Now yes, I am ranting about something that nobody really talks about anymore and is about a year or two old, but I feel that the passage of time allows for better and more analytical thoughts than an immediate answer. Sometimes. So, continuing where I left off in my Advent Children video, this movie is mandatory to watch in order to understand certain important aspects of Final Fantasy XV. I hate when studios do this. I get it, money is good to have, and getting money from more forms of media other than video games is good for widespread appeal and advertising. But why does the side material have to have important information? This movie explains what happens to Exomnia while Noctis and the gang were having fun, how Luna got the Ring of the Lucii, while also explaining how the ring works to anyone not part of the royal family, what happened to Ravus's arm, so on and so forth. This is all important information to the plot of the main game, but some people either do not want to watch the movie or might not know that it even exists or that it is important to the game. The game should have this information as some people might not be devoted enough to seek it out and they really shouldn't have to. I'm fine with having a movie spin-off and an anime spin-off, but if anything, they should only help to expand the world and lore, but not for information that should be in the main product to be in those products. For a clear example of what I'm talking about, see how Yoko Taro has important information regarding his games in books, drama CDs, interviews, and other content that is exclusive to Japan, yet might have important information for past and future games! Kingsglaive is not that bad, but hopefully you can see where I'm coming from with that. This movie just makes no sense. It starts off fine enough, but as the movie goes on, it just falls apart. There's a lot to go over, so excuse me if I jump from one point to another. The main motives of our protagonist and antagonist make no sense. Nyx works for the Kingsglaive and his family died years ago, so what is his motive for working on the side of good and not just betraying everyone like half the glaive does? I don't know, I guess the job pays well enough. Seriously, besides the fact that he is the protagonist, the only motivation he has to protect his king and his city is that King Regis stated that the future is important. Yeah, and? Yes, it is important, as the ending of 15 shows, and with Noctis' fate and all that, but there is no way Nyx knows that and is really just taking his king's word over everything, a king that he has questioned as Regis puts Noctis above everyone else in the city. His motives comes down to, the future is important, my king said so, so I will sacrifice my life for a prince I've never even met before. The antagonist isn't much better, but at least he has motivation. He lost his home to Niflheim, and he is angry that no one saved it. He is stuck in the past, so you get the theme of past versus future, which in concept is a great debate, but then it's revealed that he works for Niflheim and helped to take over Tenebrae and destroy Insomnia. What? His hate of Insomnia doesn't make sense, as Niflheim took them over, and if the excuse is that Insomnia didn't come to help, then how about he just work on his own to slowly but surely destroy both Niflheim and Insomnia? Why would he work with the kingdom who took over his home? To my knowledge, the movie never explains this, and brings the main motivation of our two leads into question, and we now have to wonder who to root for. Here's a problem I just thought of while writing this script, no less. Okay. So even if Tenebrae is not an enemy of Insomnia, it was taken over by Niflheim, so it is a Niflheim territory now. The fake treaty was a peace treaty through the marriage of Luna and Noctis, something that both characters want, and the catalyst for peace. So, by this logic, the treaty should only be signed once they're married, right? So even if it was all a ruse, why is Noctis leaving the city to meet Luna when Luna was flown to the city? I know the king wanted to protect Noctis, but if both of the characters still want to marry, treaty or not, why is he leaving the city to meet her while simultaneously she is coming to the city?! This gets rid of so many potential cool moments and gets rid of logic, but I'll get into that a bit later. Sorry if this is the wrong way to think, but I'm not well educated in fictional politics. I just feel like the information presented in this movie should have been explained in-game. For example, how the Ring of the Lucii works, and that those of the royal family are the ones meant to wield them, and those that are not worthy must pay the price. The game shows that the ring has three powers, Holy, Death, and Alterna, but the movies show some completely different powers. I suppose that this can be hand-waved, that the ring has different powers depending on the person wielding it, but given that the ring seems centered around death, power should have remained just as much of a constant like death is. I guess it does explain Ravus's arm, though. So, the movie did succeed on explaining something that wasn't confusing. Now that I think about it, it also helps to clarify what a Kingsglaive is when the main cast becomes glaives in the endgame. So the movie did succeed at filling in the most inconsequential gaps in the main story and left the big questions in, and made those questions more confusing. Yay! This movie does raise the question of how Noctis' power works and how the crystal works regarding it. So the crystal is what imbues power to the king and the prince, and they channel that to people, allowing everyone to summon weapons and wield magic. Okay, that's fair, and while not explained, it can be interpreted that this is the case when the people who transfer powers die, or conveniently can't summon weapons anymore, that everyone loses their weapons. However, I was under the impression that Noctis had the unique ability to teleport, but the Kingsglaive in this movie can all do that too. So the chosen prince, destined to be the king of kings, and he doesn't have any unique powers of his own. I don't know if this was a movie issue or a game issue, but it's an issue all the same. So the only thing that is left is how Insomnia fell, which, again, is something I will cover a bit later in this video. So basically the reason this movie exists, to explain certain elements of the plot of Final Fantasy XV, can and should have been explained in the game, so the movie is not needed, but then the movie still tries to be a movie and continues after the explaining. Ugh. Oh, and money. Can't forget that important detail. This just should not exist. Money is one thing, but the explanations from this movie should have been in the game. Look at the anime, Brotherhood, and how it ties to the game. Besides explaining what happened to Noctis' mother, the purpose of the show is to give more context to the relationship between the Chocobros. It is stuff that helps clear up a few things, but it's not hiding huge info needed for the game. The most important thing was Prompto's backstory and how he went from being fat to being a twink, but his DLC covers that as well, so the anime is side content that you can watch, but it's not required studying for the test that is 15's plot like this movie is. I mean, the movie's not god-awful. You can still watch it and still enjoy aspects of it. Like Advent Children Before, the film looks really good. The character models are so high quality that the first time people saw it, everyone thought it was all live action before it became clear that it was animated. That's good CG, and I wish the mainstream movies would actually look at this. The aesthetic of both the game and the movie, the whole futuristic medieval look, is really cool. Like if we were still in medieval times, but combined that with modern technology, that kind of look. And like Advent Children again, the action is pretty good as well. Except the last action scene. Over the top and awesome? Sure. Makes sense in context? Not really. Why is Glaucus as strong as the Ring of the Lucii? And even though most of the combat has been on the ground, everyone is flying everywhere now. Damn, even when trying to praise the good aspects of this movie, it still divulges into negatives. Probably one of the biggest crimes this movie commits is the absence of playing in Insomnia. We were supposed to play the downfall of Insomnia, not watch it. Even when the game was still Versus 13, we were teased with being able to play this huge set piece. Even when it was rebranded as 15, it was teased. Yet come the main game, and the biggest thing to be missing is playing in Insomnia when Niflheim attacks. Instead, it's late in the game, which is fine, but it's also now a movie. Because that's just as satisfying, right? Hell, meet up with Luna and marry in the middle of the carnage and be a cool battle couple. A lot of Insomnia shit should have been in the game, but it's not until the end, and even then it's just not the same. If you enjoy this movie, fine, but this was just a bad business idea that I am sick of Japan doing so often, and a movie that should have not been made.
Not the worst way to go. Rule well, young.
On the other side of the enjoyment coin, we have Kingsglaive. Kingsglaive. With my pension of stuttering, slurring, talking too fast, mumbling, all that good shit, and it's just, this is gonna go so smoothly, just... This is why I have a script, folks, all whatever many of you I have at the time of this video, because if I talk normally, it's just not that good. First thing I'm recording is a fucking blooper. Oh god. Why do you work with the kingdom who took over his home? I had it, damn it! This movie does raise the question of how Noctis' power works and how the crystal works regarding it. So the crystal is what imbues power to the...